This is an ODB Films production. Visit odbfilms.com today.
In Latin, Renovo means to renew, restore, or revive. This show is all about growing in our understanding and practice of faith. Past episodes are available wherever you like to listen to podcasts. I'm Doug Tuke, the Vice President of Ministry Advancement at ODB Films. And today, we dig into the memories of Doug Tuke's adolescence, and we talk about school uniforms. That's right. I went to All Saints Elementary School in Puyallup, Washington. I had a pretty good experience. It wasn't the best experience for me. I just didn't do super well with that kind of structure, but it was a pretty good experience. Certainly, my teachers were unbelievable. I loved them. They were some of the greatest women educators on the planet. But I can tell you, I wore olive green corduroys and white polo shirts and olive green sweatshirts to school. Then they changed it like right before I left to like red and gray. We thought we'd died and gone to heaven. And here's what I remember. I remember wearing a school uniform, and I remember specifically how big of a deal free dress was. So when they did actually say, you know, it was a free dress day, whatever it was, like a special occasion or whatever, and you could just wear what you want, jeans and t-shirts, it was like you might as well just shower the students with candy bars. It was the coolest thing ever. So I have emotional skin in this show. I'm kind of excited about it. Let's do some history. Let's talk about kind of the modern conversation around uniforms and kind of maybe why there's some good things there. So here's what we know. Catholic missionary schools, seminaries, and kind of different convents that had academics were really the earliest. They were like the first teaching institutions in the country. Okay. So the American Catholic school system developed primarily as a response to kind of violent Catholic sentiments in the 1830s and really a desire to reinforce Catholic teaching in a religiously diverse country. And we've talked about this before. We did a great show on the early, basically American Irish. But what we know is that, you know, what were called the nativists, you know, those that had, you know, kind of second generation Americans, their hostility was sparked by the rise of Irish immigration to New York, Philadelphia, Boston, so on and so forth. And when disagreements erupted over the Protestant-based public school curriculum, and they basically prohibited the use of the Dewey Rheims Bible, American Catholics, they turned then to their church establishments to create an alternative education system. And by the time like really large numbers of Southern and Eastern European Catholics arrived in the 1880s, parochial schools were flourishing. They were all over the place. So the years that followed, they saw a real continued anti-Catholic sentiment centering on funding the schools. Now, it's important to know that there is a power struggle involving funding new schools. It also ensued within the American Catholic Church around English-speaking diocese-controlled regional schools versus sort of community-based, often multilingual parish-run schools. That's a big deal. Now, uniforms provided a method of actually kind of masking obvious class and racial diversity in dress while also providing this really kind of amazing sense of security, modesty, and real freedom of movement, particularly for females. So that's kind of the origins. Uniforms were worn in 19th century convent schools for young ladies and Catholic missionary schools to provide standards of Euro-American dress for children. Remember, this tradition already existed in many European schools and still does, but that it was kind of new to the Americas. Now, Catholic asylum schools and sort of industrial schools, they required children to be dressed in these sort of sturdy, functional outfits. Sally Dwyer McNulty, she wrote a book called Common Threads, A Cultural History of Clothing in American Catholicism. And she says by the late 19th and early 20th centuries, boys were often wearing like a military style clothing, while girls were wearing simple dresses in a style named after a former naval tailor, Peter Thompson. And these look like these kind of sailor suit dresses for girls, a lot like the turn of the century Girl Scout uniforms, these kind of single, almost like rompers, but like bigger. You could see examples of that, like Girl Scout uniforms, 1918 or so, gives you an idea. Now, both in the late 19th and the first half of the 20th centuries, navy or dark cloth skirts or jumpers, they were paired with a white blouse, as well as a tie and a collar. That would have been really common back then. Well, every faith-based school, they did not require a store-bought uniform. Catholic schools proudly encouraged a very unified and tidy appearance. And those of you that went to Catholic schools in the 20th century, you know this. By the 1950s, additional choices were available to those who could afford them, such as like matching or like a blazer, like a complimentary blazer or a cardigan for girls and boys, vests, outerwears, certain shoes, like Mary Jane's, if you remember those old shoes, specific bags and belts. That was a big deal. But uniforms changed throughout the 20th century dramatically. In the 1940s and 50s, A-line jumpers in Navy were very, very common. Jumpers were also kind of manufactured in burgundy and dark green. And as parochial schools became more common, remember, this is the heyday. This is when a lot of them were being built. Demand for these uniforms resulted in brown jumpers paired with yellow, tan, and mint-colored blouses by the late 1950s. But the simple navy and white uniform remained, for the most part, the standard style. Now, in the mid-1960s, plaid skirts, that's right, and blazers, they replaced all the jumpers in popularity as Catholic schools appeared in film and television. That's right. It was film and television that actually sort of inspired the colorful change, less dram colors. Here comes the plaid. That's what I had in my old school. The plaid jumper. God bless you, ladies. That's so impressive. Material also changed over time from wools, linens, and cottons to polyester and synthetic blends. That makes perfect sense. Today's uniforms are mostly like permanent press, kind of wrinkle-free and fairly stain resistant. I can't imagine how long it took for someone to develop that. Good God, in a school uniform, you're definitely going to horse around at recess and get grass stains all up and down. I'm sure my mother, she's taking time off in purgatory for all the grass stains she removed from the knees of my pants. Anyway, so a lot's been written about the pros and cons of dress code. That's just the bottom line. And how it maintains discipline and the role that uniforms play in kind of discouraging vanity, theft, or personal property and distraction from academics. And I know that, and I want to talk about that. But whether it's successful or not in promoting positive behavior, here's the thing. Uniforms are still the most identifiable feature of American parochial school academic dress. And basically, as such, they're important in documenting sort of an aspect of our nation's educational heritage. That's just the bottom line. Kids who grew up in Asia, Australia, and the UK, they probably envied American students who could strut their stuff in whatever clothing that they liked at school if they weren't in a Catholic school, or at least that's how it appeared on most American television. But besides the UK and Ireland, school-going kids in countries across Europe, they don't typically wear uniforms either. Like America and Canada, it's more common in Catholic private schools or international schools, obviously, but there's still this amazing kind of conversation around uniforms today. So in most countries in Asia and Africa, as well as in the UK, uniforms in school are compulsory. So typically, there's one standard school uniform for boys and girls at a national school, but private and like international schools can actually choose their own uniform, that kind of the whole setup, provided they meet some sort of appropriate dress. Now, in the UK, the school uniform rule goes all the way back to the 16th century, where it's believed that the Christ's Hospital in London was the first to implement them in 1552. Now you know. Now you can say, I know when this whole thing started. So as the British colony kind of grew on, former British colonized countries adopted the practice in their schools as well, like New Zealand, South Africa, Malaysia, and Hong Kong. Now, as a free country in the New World, countries in the Americas, they did not follow suit. That wasn't the case, like we talked about before. So the idea behind American schools not making school uniforms compulsory is to restrict conformity and basically gives students more freedom to express themselves, which obviously grew pretty strong in the 70s and the 80s, 1970s and 80s, that is. But it actually appears that American educators now, this is amazing, even though it was kind of born out of like, we're not like you Brits, we're not your colony, we're not going to wear your crazy weird uniforms. Now it appears that American educators are actually starting to see the benefits of wearing school uniforms, and more schools are implementing them, especially within inner cities where kids are typically coming from lower income families. Now, it's not compulsory, but Americans are starting to see a shift in several areas where kids wear uniforms to school. This is a big deal. So school uniforms are on an upward trend, specifically in those urban areas. There's a magazine called Quartzy, has a cool online component too, and they reported last year that 21.5% of U.S. public schools made it mandatory for students to wear uniforms at the end of the school year, up 13.8%. 21.5% from all the way back in 2006. That's amazing. That's a huge number, 21.5%. That's almost a fourth. That's crazy. Now, why? According to Quartzy, this is what they say. While there's no conclusive evidence that they boost student performance, although there is some, we'll talk about that later, administrators view them as helpful in creating a sense of community and a school culture that fosters seriousness about learning. That's kind of interesting. So it can also help reduce instances of bullying, and it can also instill kind of a sense of pride in their school. That's just kind of the bottom line. There's an organization called Success Academy, and their spokesperson, Anne Michaud, I'm not sure if I said that right, M-I-C-H-A-U-D. It's basically, it's the largest public charter school network in New York City. Anyway, she says, the idea is to support equality, period. So if children are dressed in the same or similar fashion, they aren't distracted by each other's clothing and judgments about what others are wearing. Uniforms are an equalizer. Okay, so having a standard school uniform, here's the thing. It also helps parents from lower income families who feel obliged to keep up with dressing their children in the latest fashions. And that can be expensive. And there's data to back that up, which is kind of amazing. So uniforms, which change according to the season, they also ensure that children are dressed appropriately for the weather. These are legit. These are legit concerns. OK, so there's a company online called pro.con.org. And they have a line, they say in an article, that proponents say that school uniforms make schools safer for students, create a level playing field that reduces socioeconomic disparities, and encourage children to focus on their studies rather than their clothes. And in the New Yorker, the famous New Yorker magazine, there's an author, Mark Oppenheimer, and he said that approximately 1/5 of all public school students wear school uniforms, and that they are one of the few interventions on which charter school advocates and anti-charter advocates agree. It's actually a point of agreement, if you can believe that. So he wrote, actually, he found that his daughter's school uniform was really nice and he liked it. And instead of a standard school uniform, they're allowed to kind of mix and match a combination of a bunch of different kind of coordinated prep wear, skirts or pants paired with polo shirts or, you know, different colors, yellow, navy, white, topped off with kind of fleece zip up, you know, vest or jackets with the school crest on them. And he says, Oppenheimer says in this article in the New Yorker, for her first day, she chose the navy skirt with the white polo. As she walked to the corner to catch the bus, I was reminded of a time when our schools were orderly, our teachers respected, and our children all above average. That was an imaginary time, of course, but nostalgia for it has helped to create the modern school uniform movement, which is one the kind of broad, indeed, really uniform support that exists for no other educational policy or social policy that one can think of. Again, that's from the New Yorker. That's kind of interesting. In YouGov Omnibus, it's an online service. They did a survey and they found that many Americans support the idea of uniforms. And then they believe that, quote, uniforms have positive effects on combating bullying and discrimination, encouraging discipline, promoting school pride, and reducing decision fatigue, which is, that's something interesting to talk about. I have a good friend. His name is Brian Murdaugh. He's just pretty brilliant designer, has an incredible kind of computer design company. And I was joking with him one time because he wears a similar outfit fairly regularly. And I said, man, you've got this kind of khaki pant button up shirt down. And he looks at me and he goes, Doug, I got to tell you, I got a closet full of this outfit because I don't want to think about it. I don't want to waste any brain energy on what I wear each day. And I thought, OK, man, hey, that works for you because you're super successful and wonderful. So good for you. But listen, when it comes to assessing whether uniforms have a positive or a negative impact in terms of promoting students' individuality, the results are really mixed. So don't walk away from the show thinking like you got some goldenrod answer. That's not the case. The data says, while 30% of parents say it has a positive effect, 31% say there's a negative effect. And among the total population, about 1/4, 26%, say it has a positive effect on promoting individuality, while 35% think it has a negative effect in this regard. And here's the deal. Tons of schools in America who have not made it compulsory for kids to wear school uniforms, they're making their dress codes way more stringent anyway. And this has resulted in a lot of pushback from both parents and school children who feel dress codes and school uniform rules promote sexism, racism, restrict creative expression, and then they cause a lot of identity. And actually, recently there was a widely reported case in North Carolina about a federal judge's ruling to strike down a school's uniform policy as unconstitutional. Unbelievable, right? So the case, it stemmed from a school petition where female students felt the skirt requirement in their school was a sexist rule and sparked a larger discussion about how females are often at a disadvantage when it comes to school uniform rules, as they aren't allowed to wear pants. Seems to me like that would be the solution. Just allow them to wear pants. Why wouldn't they be allowed to wear pants? Anyway, the judge, Malcolm J. Howard, he wrote in the ruling, he says, quote, "The skirt requirement causes the girls to suffer a burden the boys do not, simply because they are female." I kind of agree with that. I guess that'd be fun to argue about. Anyway, as reported by the New York Times, quote, "In the U.S., more than half of public schools have dress codes. Students are beginning, they're kind of starting to push back on ones that they deem discriminatory, challenging rules against buzz cuts, shirt dresses, short dresses, that should be, and then like long hair extensions." There's also some data. In 2014, a group of New Jersey high schoolers, they created this hashtag, "I am more than a distraction," hashtag "I am more than a distraction," to push back against their dress code. And 4 years later, it continues to be an active hashtag. Change.org lists over 500 dress code petitions in their database, which is interesting. I'm not sure I agree that we should do away with dress code. I've been around young people, and I think sometimes there's a real lack of judgment in what they wear. And it amazes me sometimes, too, how their parents defend what they wear, even though, holy stromboli, some of it is very revealing, both for boys and girls. Let's not kid ourselves. So here's the thing. Despite the backlash over certain dress codes, there's still tons of support for it. Lots more schools are introducing school uniforms in the country. That's just the bottom line. And it really remains to be seen whether it's going to continue on an upward trend or not. But at the moment, it appears pretty much likely. There are some key attributes to school uniforms. And I want to talk about those. And there's some great data to back these up. And here's what they are. The first one is behavior. Education experts have noted that a school uniform requirement encourages students to behave appropriately in the classroom. It changes school behavior. This is after tons of studies. So having this rule is an observable indication that the school is a structured environment with specific behavioral expectations, which in turn leads to more students following them. That's what it says in the National Association of Elementary School Principals study from 2013. And it also reported that upon instituting dress code requirements, schools saw an 85% positive impact on classroom discipline and a 79% positive impact on student safety. And I'm sure that's regarding bullying, which is amazing. The other one is a word that we don't usually associate with parochial school, but I'm gonna, because I think it's kind of important. My friend Jason Dieterman just did a great talk on this for our OSV Talks event that we produced. We'll tell you more about that later on. But it's the word professionalism, because here's the thing. You don't think in terms of professionalism when it comes to school, but it actually really does apply. So picture the workplace. Most employers, they want you to be comfortable, but they have to set limits of some kind. So imagine wearing your most comfortable pajamas to work in this outfit. I mean, are you going to work hard, or are you wanting to kind of slouch down in your chair and take a nap? So I'm betting on the nap here. But it's amazing how much what you wear affects your state of mind. And I could not agree with this more. I work from home, and I can tell you right now, I go out of my way to dress like I'm going to work because it helps me focus on working. So wearing professional clothes, or in this case, following a strict dress code, it does. It sends a signal to your brain saying, hey, it's time to go to work, which in turn leads to higher achievement overall. The NAESP, same organization, it also reported that schools that introduced a uniform policy saw a 64% positive impact on student achievement. Wow. I mean, think about the words like dress for success. That really is good advice. The last one is, or the second to last one, I should say, is really about kind of like modesty. It's like a G-rated style. We can all picture articles of clothing that would be considered sort of distracting and even offensive. This is very true. It's true in schools. It's true in youth ministry. It's just true among young people, period. And this category can include anything from like a t-shirt, a logo that's distracting, from outfits that are just too short, or jeans that sag well below the waist, all that other stuff. Without a uniform, what is and what is not appropriate becomes really controversial. However, like a dress code, I mean, if you don't have a uniform and you have a dress code, it's kind of controversial. However, when there's a uniform dress code in place, there's no question and there's no debate. And I think that private schools are onto something there, where they can just avoid that whole, all that language. The last one is, it's leveling the playing field. Let's face it. There's more talk about fashion in school than there is sometimes in like a Vogue magazine, for crying out loud. So the conversation isn't always positive. This is really tough on young people. So kids are under a lot of pressure to wear the right jeans, the right shoes, the right socks, for crying out loud. And those who don't, whether it's a matter of style or money, they're often the subject of teasing and bullying. And I've said it about three times in the show, this should not be ignored. When all students are adhering to the same dress code, that problem is literally eliminated. I mean, it's gone. There's a level playing field. It's also an opportunity to wear your pride on your sleeve. You know, students who wear a uniform, they embody a sense of uniformity and community. In other words, a dress code creates kind of feelings of belonging and a school spirit. And these feelings are pretty beneficial for students of all ages. I did a lot of work at Marist High School in Eugene, Oregon. I'm really a fan of that school. I just think it's extraordinary. And they've done something kind of creative with this. They basically just say to underclassmen, you need to wear, something that says Marist on it. You have a lot of freedom, no holes in your pants and not too short of skirts. But you every day, whether that's a blouse, a fleece, a T-shirt, a hoodie, whatever it is, it's a Marist something. Now, obviously, people are going to be shopping at your bookstore, which that makes a huge difference. But it's also kind of nice just to have that school pride that goes with it. And in my opinion, it shows. I saw that when I was there. So school uniforms all the way back to 1552 in the UK. God bless the Catholic schools in the 1950s. Thank you so much for plaid. I do think there's benefits. I do think it honors and brings out the best in students. And I think that it's kind of cool that it's part of our Catholic identity. Thanks for listening. Sincerely, we're partners in the journey of faith, and I really hope you'll share this Renovo podcast with friends and foes. Send your topic suggestions, questions, and or comments to doug@odbfilms.com. Always remember to engage the tradition and live the conversion. Until next time, God bless.